The Buddha's speech on friendliness. What should the clever one advantageously do to attain this state called peace is this. He should be intelligent, straight, honest, humble, gentle, and never proud, contented and easy to support, not busy, careful, and silenced, in abilities and senses, cautious and modest, neither flattering families nor be demanding, not doing even a minor trifle that other wise men might criticize. Then he should think, may all beings be joyous and safe. Let every creature's mind rejoice. Whatever breathing beings there are, no matter whether feeble or firm, with none excepted, whether long, tall, big, medium, short or small, whether seen or unseen, visible or not, whether living far away or near here, whether existing or just about to come into being, let every living being's mind be exultantly jubilant. Let no one ever kill or another being undo, nor ever harm anyone anywhere at all. Let no one wish even a minor bad for another, neither from provocation nor from revenge. Thus, as a mother with her own life might guard her only baby child, thus should he maintain a mentality of infinite friendliness for every living being, in gentle sympathy for this entire universe, unlimited, endless, and waste. As above, so below, and all around, unimpeded, without any hatred, purged of all enmity, whether standing, walking, seated, or lying down, while slumbering, he should always maintain such awareness of gentle and benevolent kindness. This very mentality is the divine dwelling here, they say. He that do not traffic with many speculative views, perfected in seeing what is right and wrong, purged of lust for sense pleasures, he will surely not come back here to any womb. And the canonical source for this Buddhist speech on friendliness is the minor readings and the illustrator, the Kudaka.
Hello to you, friends. Another talk and walk on early Buddhist philosophy and praxis. And today we'll make a little guided Metta meditation on universal friendliness. The root word of Metta is Mitta and basically means friend. And it's worth noting that the next Buddha Metta means actually, his name means the friendly one. Ajita Metta, the unconquerable friend. Where he is now, he is also very friendly towards all beings. So this Metta meditation is one of the classic 40 meditation objects in early Buddhism. And it's part of a group of four called the Brahma Viharas. Brahma means divine or best, and Vihara means a dwelling. It can also mean a temple where you dwell in. So it means the best dwelling or the divine dwelling. And this is because if you die in one of these divine dwellings, then you come into company with those who dwell in it. And this is from the Brahma Deva, from level 12 and upwards, so fairly high. The four Brahma Viharas start actually with Metta, which is also a mental perfection, a parami, the ninth mental perfection, so a fairly subtle one. The other ones is Karuna, compassion or pity, Mudita, mutual joy, rejoicing in others' success, and Upekkha, which is equanimity, evenness of mind, undisturbable imperturbability. Upekkha Parami. But today we'll talk about Metta, which is a wonderful state. Oh, I feel 140 millimeters rain the last two nights. So one can see it has gone down the mountain. Nevertheless, Metta is something that counteracts one of the root defilements, of which there is three: greed, hate, and ignorance. Hate is called dosa in Bali. This hate is basically any kind of thing where the mind is against something. It wants to push something away in different kind of grades or delusions or degrees. So if you take raw hate, either against a person, a group of persons, an organization or a phenomenon, then you can dilute, then you get anger, rage, wrath. If you take that and dilute that, then you get irritation. If you take and dilute that, then you get opposition, aversion against. If you take and dilute that a little bit, then you get mental rigidity, a form of stubbornness, where you do not want to change your mind. All these are different degrees of the same mental defilement, where the mind is against something, where greed is the opposite, it is for something, it wants to have something. In greed and in hate, the mind wants to be free from something, it wants to push it away. So they come up, arise and cease at the same time, this greed and hate. One can have little overbalance to one of the sides, but basically they come up and cease at the same time. It's very, very nice place here. Very, very nice place. So here we'll stay a little bit. So Metta Parami is developed specifically by the Buddha to counteract this hate, this anger, this dosa. And you can say hate, aversion, anger, opposition towards something is a habitual pattern of the mind. It does not need to be so, but it's a habitual pattern of the mind caused by emotional overreaction. So it's usually caused by and habitually reinforced over many lives by painful feeling, unpleasant feeling, feeling of frustration, despair. Then whatever object, whatever situation has caused this despair to arise, this make then hate arise. Hate towards that object, situation, person or group of people. So the Buddha said there's three situations where hate usually arises. It is on the thought that this person or these persons, this group of people, this organization, this political party or whatever it is, they in the past they did wrong to me, or in the present they do wrong to me now, or in the future I think they will do wrong to me. Or this person, thing, organization, group of people, they have done wrong to somebody I like in the past. Or they are doing wrong or bad or evil to somebody I like now. Or they will do wrong, bad and evil to somebody I like in the future. Or the third option is that one reflects that this group of people, this organization, this person has done good to someone who is my enemy in the past. Or they are helping my enemy now. Or they are assisting and promoting those who are against me, or they will do that in the future. So then this aversion, this hate arises. And what is the antidote? This is systematic practice of this friendliness. Best done in the morning with closed eyes, where one sits alone, ideally, but can also sit in small groups, but it should be a silent place. And then one wishes systematically in at least six directions, in the front, to the right, back, left, up and down. By the force of all our accumulated good-doing merit, may all beings in the frontal quadrant in this direction, may they gain, win, and sustain infinite friendliness, infinite goodwill, infinite friendship, and thereby come to know harmlessness and innocence. May those to the right, to the back, to the left, as above, so below, may they attain, gain, and maintain, sustain infinite friendliness, infinite goodwill, infinite kindness towards all beings without exception, and thereby gain harmlessness and innocence. May all these beings on this island, in this city, on this continent, on this planet, in this galaxy, in this universe, in this multiverse, in this entire cosmos, may they attain, gain, sustain, and maintain infinite friendliness, infinite goodwill, infinite friendship with all sentient beings without exception. May all these beings join this friendliness, this goodwill, this kindness, this genuine love from the heart. May they join this with awareness. May they join this friendliness with examination. May they join this friendliness with enthusiastic energy. May they join, fuse this friendliness with joy. May they mix this friendliness with tranquility. May they join, assist this friendliness with concentration. And may they finally join, enforce, bolden this goodwill, this friendliness, this genuine kindness. May they join this with undisturbable equanimity. So these are the seven links to enlightenment, the Sambhuyanga. And they embolden, enforce this friendliness. In the daily life, in practical terms, in the bus, in the queue, on the workplace, wherever one needs a quick one, a quick mantra for this one, then one can say the following. May all beings be happy. May the person in this queue be happy. May the person in this shop be happy. May the persons in this bank, in this company, wherever it is, may they be happy. May they be content. May they find friendliness and goodwill in their life and among their associates and family. This counteracts this inborn tendency to feel despair or feel anger towards something unpleasant information one is bombarded with every day. It can be terrorism on the television, or the wrong political party, they win the election, or there's divorce in the friend's family, or there's somebody else promoted at the job, or whatever. So one will often emotionally react with opposition against these parties that one dislike for this or that reason. And this has this unfortunate, detrimental, and self-destructive effect that as soon as there is just a grain of hate, a grain of irritation, a small atom of opposition or aversion in the mind, then happiness gone. It goes away. Because happiness and hate, even in diluted derivatives, they cannot coexist in the mind. They cannot be together in the mind. This means that if there's hate, there's no happiness. And if there's happiness, which one can induce by this infinite friendliness, then hate goes away. An important feature is that one should try to make it infinite. It also has an epithet in the Pali text, and it's appamanna brahmavihara. This means the infinite best stage. So one should make it infinite, both in time. May these beings meet infinite friendliness in an eternal time, infinite in space, out to the outermost non-definable border of any multiverse or cosmos, an infinite number of beings, whatever sentient beings that are in this cosmos, may they also gain, attain, and maintain this infinite friendliness. Over a long time, this friendliness lifts up the mind from many unhappy states that is connected with this hate, aversion, grudge towards this person, this event or that event, this situation or that situation. So as soon as this grudge, this grunt, this anger, opposition, aversion, which is very bitter, it goes away from the mind. And it cannot be there together with friendliness, together with goodwill, together with kindness. As soon as kindness is there, then hate, aversion evaporates. In the beginning, and this one should know, whilst training it, one has difficulty with feeling it genuinely. One feels like I'm faking it. And this can be because one intellectualizes it and try only feel it when here. One should try to get it down to the heart region and then beam from heart to all other beings' heart. And in the queue, if somebody is irritated at you in the supermarket queue, then beam from your heart to their heart. Then you see how this growing conflict fizzle out. And they will help you. So from heart to heart, genuinely, that's what metta, friendliness, is about. It's not kind of like a swapping of pleasure, like any relationship where sex is involved. Is like it's something genuine that you are friendly. You can be friendly towards everyone, animals, devas, of whatever gender, of whatever orientation. You can be friendly towards. So it's a very genuine and very deep, and I would say transcendent feeling, emotion, mental state, and praxis that the Buddha always advised when his monks should go out to dying people, and these were Hindus, that whose spiritual goal is to be unified with Brahma, which they believe is the creator of the universe. And can one come into an association with Brahma? Yes, one can. By what praxis? One can by this praxis. Because the Brahmas, they stay, even though they, in the ideal case, Mahabrahmas, they live 150 billion years. Then they live for these 150 billion years without even one single moment of irritation. they are continuously dwelling in this first jhana of friendliness or of mutual joy or of compassion or of equanimity. So they have not ever been nor will they ever be, as long as they are Brahmas, against anybody or anything whatsoever. And this is worth noticing for the human state now, where you can see war and conflict and opposition and arguments and quarrels and fights all over the place, basically. This one should know, there's a class of beings where this never happened and never have happened and never will happen. All this turmoil, all this suffering, all this fight, opposition, aversion, hate, anger, rage, war, terrorism, political antagonizing, and so on. Favoritism with this group, while aversion against that group. All this is not known there. Why have they come there, these beings, these Brahma beings? Because they have practiced this practice of infinite friendliness, systematically, over a period of years. So much that at the moment of death, their penultimate moment, just before dying, then they could bring themselves to the first jhana, to the first mental absorption of this infinite friendliness. So having died in that state, in that particular state of mind, that conditioned their consciousness to relocate at that particular level 12 and upwards, where we are on level 5. So it's definitely not a small thing to do. It's not a small thing to do. And I think it should be taught everywhere, in school, to everyone. But now I start with you. May all beings come to learn that metta, paramita, that universal, infinite friendliness, goodwill, harmlessness, kindness, gentleness, amity. May they all come to know it. May they all dwell in it constantly, achieving high mental jhana and ecstatic joy by this being completely innocent and goodwill towards all beings at all times. Thank you. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha.
There is a very good mantra in Buddhism, in early Buddhism, in Pali, and it goes like this: Sabba satta bhavantu sukhitatta. Sabba satta, all beings, bhavantu, may become sukhi, happy, tatta, thus or in this way. Sabba satta bhavantu sukhi tatta. May all beings become thus happy. Sabba satta bhavantu sukhi tatta. May all beings, without any exception, be happy in this very way. Sabba satta bhavantu sukhi tatta. May all beings become thus happy. Sabba satta bhavantu sukhi tatta. May all beings become such happy. Sabba satta. Whoop. Bhavantu sukhi tatta. May all beings become happy
by following the Noble Eightfold Way. In this way, tata. Sattvasatta bhavantu sukhitata. May all beings, even my enemies, my worst enemies, may they also become happy. Sattvasatta bhavantu sukhitata. May all beings become happy by knowing, seeing, understanding, and practicing the way to happiness, by knowing the true Dhamma. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. May you be happy and have a nice day.